This is 20 Minutes Live. Welcome to all of you from India and around the world. I am Ninad Karpe, partner at 100x.vc. Today at 20 Minutes Live, we have Mr. Ramanan. Ramanan is currently the Mission Director of Atal Innovation Mission, Additional Secretary, Niti Aayog, Government of India. The Atal Innovation Mission is a strategic and holistic national innovation initiative spanning schools, universities, industry, and NGO. It's very, very wide in its expanse. Ramanan is an old friend of mine, but besides that, he was previously Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer and member of the board of CMC Limited. As you're familiar, CMC is a subsidiary of Tata Consultancy Services, TCS. Ramanan's illustrious career in the IT industry spans more than three decades when he joined TCS and in 1981, after graduating from IIT Bombay. He has received significant national and international recognition for his contribution to the IT industry and digital world. We're all proud of his achievements. In fact, our format is simple, unique, and crisp. Ramanan will provide his opening remarks in 10 minutes, and after that, we'll have a round of Q&A for 10 minutes. If you have any question, please post it in the window on your screen and I will moderate the session after Ramanan has spoken. We are so delighted, Ramanan, you're here with us today on 20 Minutes Live. Over to you for 10 minutes comments.
Thank you, Ninad, and good evening to everybody. And I hope all of you who are on this call are hale and healthy in spite of the very difficult times that we are all in. And I hope all of you are practicing the COVID-19 safeguards. Never before in the history of our times, at least over the last several hundred years maybe, have we come across such an unprecedented situation like the COVID-19 crisis. And from an India perspective, the COVID-19 crisis has highlighted, if not anything else, the great importance of innovation and entrepreneurship that needs to permeate the length and breadth of our country. I, of course, am very fortunate to be able to head this very important mission called the Atal Innovation Mission. The focus of the Atal Innovation Mission, as all of you may be aware, is to promote and create an ecosystem of innovation and entrepreneurship across the length and breadth of a country. Now, why is this so important? It is important because we are a country of 1.3 billion people. We have more than 1.4 million schools in our country. We have 10,500 engineering and related institutions. We have more than 39,000 colleges. And we have 150 million young students who are going to be entering into the workplace over the next 5 to 10 years. And these are the people who have to carry this nation forward, the 1.3 billion people. And we have a number of challenges in our country. While we have been one of the fastest growing economies of the world, and we have many positive things going in the country, we also have 22% of our country still below the poverty line. We have more than 44% of our country agri-economy based. We have only 8 tier one cities in our whole country. We have more than 100 smart cities identified, but they yet have to become smart cities and have to become hubs of job creation and innovation. So there is a very important need. What has led us to this point in time in terms of a job seeking mentality and a mindset that we have had in our country and which has served us well. We are, after all, a $150 billion IT/ITS industry or $180 billion IT/ITS industry today. And that has grown tremendously because of our focus on education, because of our knowledge seeking, and because of our job seeking capabilities and our qualifications. But it is high time for us to create and promote an ecosystem of innovation and entrepreneurship across India, which is going to address these various challenges. The challenges of affordable housing, the challenges of drinking water and sanitation, the challenges of smart cities, the challenges of job creation for everybody. So we need to become a nation of job creators from a nation of job seekers. Now, that is why this COVID-19 crisis, while it is a crisis and needs to be addressed immediately, it is very important for us to look upon this as an opportunity, an immense opportunity, a once in a lifetime opportunity in the history of a nation to be able to reboot itself and address challenges that are there, which can be converted into entrepreneurial opportunities and which can be converted into innovations. I am heading a group, interministerial group in the government between DBT, DST, Atal Innovation Mission, Startup India, Invest India, and we launched a search for solutions from the startup community. After all, we are a 30,000 startup nation. But how do we ensure that these startup country or the startup companies are delivering? And we were amazed to find that more than 2,000 innovations, startup innovations came, which were pivoted from where they were for COVID-19 ready to deploy solutions. And in the post COVID-19 world, the challenges are many for us. The whole problem of urban migration, the problem of agriculture, and so on and so forth. But it has been encapsulated beautifully by the Honorable Prime Minister. And I would like to just stress on those 5 points, which are very important, because every one of those pillars that he identified demand innovation, demand entrepreneurship, demand the startups to be able to give their best in order to achieve whatever goals we have, and for them to be able to become large companies, to become unicorns, to become multinational organizations. The first and foremost pillar that he identified was a demographic dividend. We have 65% of our country under 35 years old. We have a demographic dividend that is the envy of many a country, and we have 150 million young students. But we have to ensure that they get a problem-solving, innovative mindset, and they get the opportunities for entrepreneurship. You know, we are never lack for great innovators. When they go abroad, they do extraordinarily well. Satya Nadella heading Microsoft, Sundar Pichai heading Google, Shantanu Narayan heading Adobe. How do we create hundreds and thousands of these people in our country? By providing that ecosystem of innovation. And that is why the Atal Innovation Mission has launched tinkering labs across 5,000 tinkering labs in schools across the country to promote this innovative thinking, the problem-solving mindset that is so needed in our young school students. And then we are promoting world-class incubators in Atal incubators. More than 100 world-class incubators are being set up. Each incubator would foster 25 to 30 startups, which means in 100 incubators, you're going to have 5,000 startups over the next 4 years. We are setting up Atal community innovation centers in underserved regions of the country, because we want to promote innovation so that it reaches the masses. It reaches the tribal district, the rural districts. We have 115 aspirational districts out of the 733 districts that we have. We want to ensure that the benefits of innovation go and reach that. We are launching Atal New India Challenges so that you will have product innovations which will have an impact on the society and on the economy. And it will enable the startup to actually be able to find a buyer for the product. So the ministries are helping in order to launch these challenges, and the ministry will be a buyer of your solution. And finally, we're launching Arise, which is Applied Research and Innovation for Small Enterprises, so that the medium small enterprises, which is 70% of our economy, is based on the informal sector. And if we don't have the MSME sector being very innovative, and then Make in India will not be a success. And Nitin Gadkariji has said that, you know, while our GDP contribution is only 29% from the MSME industry, we need to make sure that it can become 50%. And how do we do that? By stimulating innovation. So the four pillars: one, the demographic dividend. Second is the infrastructure. You know, we need to have a uniform development of our country. Otherwise, our country is not going to change. And this COVID-19 has brought to stark focus the importance of our communities to develop, our remote districts to develop. We don't want urban migration all migrating to the seven tier one cities. We want them to develop at various places. So we need to create job hubs, innovation hubs, and address the entrepreneurial challenges that are there, either in a tribal, hilly district, coastal district. How do we, for example, help the fishing industry in the coastal districts? How do we help e-commerce drive requirements and changes in the tribal communities and the hilly districts? How do we use renewable energy to prevent further disasters? So there are a whole lot of, you know, India is a country of a billion people with a million challenges. And these million challenges are a million opportunities for us to be able to pivot our solutions and create solutions for the future. And second, thirdly, technology, the pillar of technology, because technology become available, affordable, accessible, and it is advanced. And that is why we are having technologies like 3D printing, robotics, IoT devices, miniaturized electronics, augmented virtual reality, do-it-yourself kits in our schools, so that our young school students get exposed to what are the latest technologies upon which solutions of the world are being created. And technology can play an immense role, as you can see right now. We are talking all together and conversing because of the fact that we have this huge impact of technology. And finally, we are talking of the demand. You know, India is a country which has tremendous demand, and the startups have to use this opportunity at this point in time to cater to this demand. We have demand in terms of the districts, the remote districts. We have demand in terms of the various services required, and we have a demand for Make in India to make a self-reliant, reliable India. And we don't need to look elsewhere for catering to this demand. So all in all, we have a fantastic opportunity at this point in time to leverage innovation, to leverage entrepreneurship, to leverage technology, digital technology and digital transformations to drive the growth of our nation. And in all this, I also want to say that social innovation is absolutely paramount, because without that element of social innovation, our country will still experience the digital divide, the divide between the rich and the poor, and the divide between the haves and the have-nots. So when we integrate social innovation into commercial innovation, and every social innovation will have commercial banking, there is absolutely no doubt about it. I think this is the time in the history of a country where we have to take it by the horns, the opportunity by the horns, and go forward and become great innovators and entrepreneurs, because India has that innovative capability. I have traveled around the world and I've seen our people are second to none, in fact, better than most, because our ability to grasp and our humility and our unassumingness are very, very important traits in the whole thing of innovation, because you reach across, you help, you form teams and you work together. And finally, I want to say that this COVID-19 has brought one thing to the fore, and that is the convergence of government, private sector, industry, institutions like Ninad Karpe's institution, all have come together. And this is a watershed moment in our history. The previous such occurrence was in the Y2K. When Y2K happened, then all the countries became aware of the capabilities of India. Similarly, at this point in time, whether it is corporate, industry, government, suddenly we are realizing the importance of the startup community. And so for the startup community, they are waking up and they're saying, hey, these are the guys who are going to provide the solutions. These are the guys who are going to create the destiny of our country. We need to support them. We need to work with them and we need to collaborate. And in this collaboration, we will find the solutions that our country needs and the economic progress that is assured for a country of our size. And we'll set the model for the rest of the world.
Amazing, amazing. Ramanan, I think, you know, in a short span of 10, 12 minutes, you packed in a lot of stuff. You said this is a watershed moment. This is the time. India's land of billion people with billion opportunities. I think, you know, a lot of interesting, if I had a Twitter going on, I could have kept on tweeting continuously.
Thank you.
So there are a lot of questions. So, you know, Ramanan, you'll have to be a little short, because I mean, I can already see many, many questions. Some of your old friends, Mudit Jain, you know, as usual, very, very straight and upfront. He's asking, how can India be a land of so startup opportunities given the bureaucratic and tax procedures? Do you want to quickly respond to that?
Yeah, I think, you know, bureaucracy has been there and it cannot be wished away. But at the same time, I find that the government is doing a whole lot of initiatives to encourage innovation, entrepreneurship. And you have now 250 incubators, and there is a lot of challenges, a lot of policy changes in Startup India, in the MSME. For example, every startup, they should register themselves as an MSME, because the scope and definition of MSME has been increased. So I think there are a number of government policies which are very proactive towards startups. And they have also inducted people like me from the private world. And you already have a number of private people entering into the government, because they have realized this need of government bureaucracy to be a little tamed perhaps by a private sector, and also a practical view taken about what the needs of business are.
So Biren Ghosh has asked an interesting question. As a government, are you open to joint partnership with industry partners? No, Biren obviously is more interested in computer graphics, but broadly, can you quickly respond to that?
In fact, very good for having asked that question. Every initiative of Atal Innovation Mission is tied up with private sector. So we are very strongly encouraging partnerships. In fact, we wanted to split this public-private sector partnership to private-public sector partnership. You know, always the thing is public sector seeking private sector help. Why not the other way around? Why not private sector come proactively? And we are creating the platform to do that. We'll be very, very happy to encourage any partnership with any of the private sector entities.
Sure. So Anirudh Kadwekar is asking about resources available with universities and professors. How do you, you know, tap those that resource and connect to industry and startups?
Yeah. So first of all, many of the incubators that are being set up, we have taken an explicit proactively to see that there is a diversity of universities, institutions, and industry having incubators, so that the resources of the university, the research lab, the technology labs become accessible to these incubators and to the startups. You see, many of them are just getting wasted because they are not directed towards applied innovation and so on. So that is first a minimum condition, that whenever an applicant applies for an incubator, if it is a university, then they should make available all their resources for the purpose of incubation. Also, we are encouraging a whole lot of targeted research which is required for the startup community and which is required by the country. So many of the universities, there is an innovation cell which has been set up. 1,000 universities have set up innovation cells, and these innovation cells are driving what are the possibilities, and we are integrating that into the curriculum of the universities.
So Ramanan, there's an interesting question, and you know, it's a large question, but again, I would request you to give kind of quick response because there's so many questions. How are you relevant to Bharat, to rural India, to person only in regional language? Yeah. How do you? So it's a large question, but quick response.
So all the initiatives that we have, like Atal Tinkering Labs, we are actually doing it in multiple languages. Atal Tinkering Labs, we have 5,000 tinkering labs across 650 districts, and we are making sure that the medium of instruction, online training materials, YouTube sessions, they are having a combination of languages, and we encourage that. Secondly, we are also making sure that 150 community innovation centers are being set up in every state. Every state will have 3 or 4 of those community innovation centers, which are in underserved regions of the country and where rural innovation is going to be encouraged. And therefore, the language barriers and all of that will be broken, because we'll have local innovators from the community who are, and we are supporting them and converting Jugaad innovation into systemic innovation.
Good. Converting Jugaad to systematic. Good one. Yeah. There's a question from an NRI, Rajiv. He's asking, how do you involve NRI investors and innovators in this process? Both, yeah. Community of both.
So it is great. I think if he writes to me, I'll send him all of that information. But we want many of the NRI investors to partner with us to become mentors of change for many of our incubator startups, because there would be each NRI or each investor may be interested in some area, and some may be interested in agri-tech, or some may be interested in biotech and so on. Some may be technologically oriented. And we are creating platforms so that our startups and our incubators will get exposure to these NRIs and to the investment community. And so we'll be organizing many webinars along with the investor community for our startups. We have more than 2,000 startups, by the way, in the last 2 years, which have come up because of the incubators that we have set up. And they all are hungering for exposure about what they are doing and the product. So we'll be very happy to facilitate that.
Sure. There are a couple of questions, but I'll take last 2-3. Nikki, she's a startup founder, she's saying. She's asking, how can EdTech or EduTech startups collaborate with the government to reach out to tier 2, tier 3 cities?
Yeah, so EdTech startups have a great future. Thanks for bringing that up. I think the whole education sector is going to undergo a radical change because of online medium. It is already happening. We from Atal Tinkering Labs, for example, have launched Tinker from Home modules. 4 modules we launched, one on artificial intelligence, one in game development, one on 3D design, and one on creativity, digital creativity and skills. Now this, we want EdTech platforms to approach us. We will give them the opportunities. Also, many states and many districts are very keen to leverage EdTech, because they don't have access to good teachers or mentors, or they don't even have access maybe to certain labs and so on. So there is an opportunity for us to leverage digital education and digital distance learning in a very innovative way, so that you can create blended learning. You undergo some classroom training, and then they can come, and the classroom training can be in innovation hubs or tinkering labs which are set up at different places, and then you can have distance learning and online learning.
Are entrepreneurs born, or you can train a person to become entrepreneur?
I fundamentally believe, Nina, that every person is a born innovator. And my simple example is, when we were a small baby, nobody taught us to walk, nobody taught us to speak. You watched the world around you. You got up, fell down, got up again, fell down. But every time you did that, you innovated and you started running and you started winning races. And you never used to talk, and now I'm talking 19 to the dozen. So all of this is just observing lip movements, getting information, and you are innovating all the time. So this is lesson number one that we try to teach to every person in our school. You are a born innovator. You are a born entrepreneur. Somewhere in the educational system, you become rigid. People start limiting themselves and thinking that they cannot innovate anymore. But if you just start looking at the problem and saying, how do I solve this? You have started on your innovation journey. And then you acquire some knowledge in the tools and the technologies and make available the ecosystem. Lo and behold, you're going to see everyone becoming a great innovator.
So I'm going to ask the last two questions. Quick response is, Ramadan, what do you think of early stage funding? Is there enough? Are companies like 100X, where I'm a partner, doing a good service? Or what do you think of a model like 100X? Where they fund early stage funding?
Yeah. First, let me answer the first question. Early stage funding is not enough for our country. We need a lot more private companies and private investment to happen, because you need to encourage these young startups who have a great idea. So you can catch them early on in the university, in the fourth year or fifth year, talented people, support them for a year or two. It's not going to cost you much, but out of that will come some great startups. And mostly VCs want a little maturity in the startup and some progress before they can fund. And that is why this government support is so important. And government is trying to do its best, but I feel government still also will have its own limitations, and a crisis like this, starts rerouting available cash for various other necessities. So we need very active private sector involvement. And I think what your organization, 100XBC, is a fantastic idea, Ninad. I want more and more such organizations to come up, because when they start encouraging Indian startups instead of just looking at foreign-based startups or foreign copy startups. I mean, they all make money. Flipkart has emulated a model, etc. Or Ola has done from Uber. But we have genuine needs in our country which have huge opportunity. Can we create platforms where millions of livelihoods is created and personalized creativity comes into being? For example, if you provide a platform for tutoring, then you have 1,000 tutors who can start tutoring. Whether it is in dance, whether it is in music, whether it is in some other subject. So we have to create platforms where the Kirana stores are able to operate with ease, where somebody who is in a tribal or a hilly district is able to sell his goods and services. As so many possibilities are there. So we need to do all of that.
I can't let you go, Ramanan, since you're an old friend. I'm asking a personal question on this public platform. Yeah. All of us have been in lockdown for a lot of time, last 8 weeks, 10 weeks. What is the first thing you'll do once it all opens up? What is that one thing you miss? And you'll go immediately on the morning when you can just go out.
The first thing I will do, Ninad, is go to see a movie in a theater. of course, we have TV and all of that stuff, but there is nothing which is of greater joy than going to a theater and seeing a movie. I hope that day comes soon when you're able to go there and not look left or right or worry about where you're sitting and so on, and still go back and enjoy the movie.
Thank you. Lovely. I hope it happens soon. I hope you're able to see a movie scene. Ramadan, in that short last 20-25 minutes, you have packed in so much information. You're so delighted you came today on this platform of 20 Minutes Live and shared your thoughts and vision. I hope we can invite you again, and I hope you'll agree to come again sometime later this year. Thank you, Ramadan, for coming.
Thank you,
viewers. Thank you, viewers, for watching 20 Minutes Live. Remember, it's every Thursday, 5 p.m. Thank you, Ramanan.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ninad. And it has been a delight to participate in this. Thank you.
Thank you.